the next video about this magazine, Radio Electronica. The final pages, transistorized power supply, loudspeaker box of Plessy, also a famous brand still nowadays as far as I know. Receivers from Nordmende, that was Germany. Microphones, Piker, very interesting. And what I want to do, of course, here also advertisements. Electronic components were quite expensive in those days. That's what I can tell. So you needed some money to have this hobby. And that's the reason why I salvaged many, many radios, televisions, took them apart, all my components. Many of my components here are still components that I found in the 1970s, 1980s, etc., etc. So I couldn't pay them, they were too expensive. So I had to take all kinds of electronic equipment apart. And I still have a lot of fun with all these old components, and sometimes you can find them in the circuit that I publish on YouTube. There were, of course, already a transistor amplifiers and high frequency transistors, but in those days the tubes were still very popular. So we had here an ultra high frequency tuner with two tubes, the PC86 and the PC88, and you could build it in a television set that had only one channel or three channels, and so you could get to the UHF band. And many people in those days, also of not many, radio amateurs made their TV set themselves. So you could buy here separate transistor chassis, and here also grades from the manufacturer was grades. And you could also buy cathode ray tubes, boxes to build in that cathode ray tube, etc. This was a radio shop that I visited many days in Amsterdam, Radio Lensen. It was a kind of flea market, and they sold everything. A trio communication receiver, small transistor radios, tape recorders, complete sets, hi-fi sets, 1976, typical the style of those days. Ultra high frequency antenna, and whole Amsterdam was in those days. On the roofs you could find everywhere antennas, and it was a kind of wood of antennas on the roofs in Amsterdam in those days, in the 1970s. After that we got cable television, so all the television cabling went underground, and now we have internet, and we have glass fiber, not everywhere, but it was the latest development, glass fiber cables over in many cities and villages in the Netherlands, in fact almost everywhere. And that had of course to do with the properties of the soil in the Netherlands, often a sand or clay, so it was in fact not very difficult to mount all these cables, to get them into the ground, approximately 1 meter deep. Electronic organs were also very popular, There were a lot of people that made their electronic organ themselves. You could buy all kind, many articles also in this magazine about how to make electronic organs. Cathode ray tubes to make your own television. Again, ultra high frequency antenna. And for the people on the borders of Netherlands, they could receive Germany with that antenna. German television stations. That could be very interesting, of course. This was also a popular address to go to. I went to this radio shop a few times in the 1970s. They also sold all kinds of electronic stuff. Tuner, mono knob transistor unit for VHF and UHF, so you could switch the channels with only one knob. Complete analog TV set, TV chassis, I mean. Tuners, tuners and more tuners. Television was booming. And here also many transistors, 2SA, that were Japanese, as far as I know, Japanese types. OSA was Europe, invented by Philips. That type numbering, O meant in fact that it had no grid. So the OSA 74 was a transistor, and it was a germanium transistor. The F always means high frequency. This must have been a high frequency transistor. The Z meant a power transistor. ALZ is a power transistor. OC is more or less common. AF, again, high frequency transistor, germanium. 2N1305, that was the American code, American way of coding transistors. And GFT. TKD was also, they had their own way of naming their transistors. C is medium power, D is, so this is a small signal transistor, AC, AD is germanium, and it is a power transistor. The D means power. Okay, bridge rectifiers. Again, transistors. You can see the radio service Twente had a lot to sell. Condensatoren, electrolytics, etc., etc. Radio Ster in The Hague was also a popular radio shop in those days. I think I visited it a few times. And here a liquidation party of radios, tube radios, and a vinyl player, advertisements, etc. I will do it completely, so, and this one. Plessy Electronics again. So perhaps it's interesting to show more in detail some things. The classic test signal for an analog TV tube, and in color TV we had, of course, colors on the screen, that beautiful function generator. WaveTech, coaxial cables, the magnetic shield. I've explained that in the first video. The good properties of the shielding material that when you hammer it or drill it or saw it, it doesn't lose its properties. Heat sinks, cooling plates, resistors that were used in space, signs making it satellites and in circuits that were used in rockets, TV in the Netherlands, all the main broadcasting transmitters in 1967, yes. Scotch tape advertisements. Connectors. The transistor voltmeter. The high frequency oscilloscope that in fact did not go to such a high frequency at all, only 1 megahertz, but it was enough to test analog televisions, though the higher frequency was already 10.7 megahertz, but anyway. Again, a lot of advertisements. The first symposium about color television. Always interesting to see how this all developed. Again, how they made magnetic tape in Germany in the BASF factory, where a specific ferrite oxide layer was dispersed to a foil. Extel oscillator, crystal oscillator in a tube unit. Fuel cells give electric energy. Made by Siemens. Of course, Siemens was a big factory and is still a big factory nowadays in 2019, with a lot of knowledge in electronics, electrical systems, etc. That's also important, very important, always important. I mean, operational amplifiers, a long article about how to prevent drift. Shortwave receiver made by a Dutch radio amateur who did his thesis, engineer thesis, on this subject. Here again, I've talked about that earlier in the preceding video, but perhaps it's interesting to show all these pictures much more in detail. You can see he made it completely. It was homebrew, but it is stunning how beautiful this shortwave radio was made and how well he could calculate everything. He really knew this radio, all its ins and outs, and of course that was necessary, otherwise he could not do his thesis. That will be clear. Again, this beautiful radio. I can't pen over the schematic somewhat, but well, only want to show it a little bit. And you can see there's a lot of work. and a lot of transformers that all had to be aligned to the specific frequencies of the VFO and of course also the input, the antenna signal, measuring equipment, model trains. I've shown it here again, that board to drive a set of model trains, also beautifully made. I think it's that was not simple to make it. Digital circuits, shift register. Interesting to show the shift register of Texas Instruments with 144 components in one enclosure on one chip. 1967. That was quite good regarding the integrated circuit technology. So I stop with the advertisements, the tuner again with two tubes. This is interesting to show again. Complete set with two loudspeaker boxes. 1967. Well, the sound was beautiful, I'm absolutely sure. With the tubes and these high quality loudspeakers, it's surely comparable to the good sound boxes that we have nowadays in 2019. Well, what's an interesting final picture? This, for instance. Interesting. Hope you enjoyed it.